pa. First, we have application of payments. Next, we have dation in payment. And then we have payment by cession. And lastly, yung tinatawag natin, tender of payment or consignation. Application of payment class is the designation of the debt to which the payment must be applied when the debtor has several obligations of the same kind in favor of the same creditor. So, for example, debtor X, creditor Y. Si debtor X ay may tatlong utang, no? Alam niyo naman yung konsepto ng palista muna, palista muna, palista ng palista. For example, sa sari-sari store, meron ng mahabang sheet of paper. Alam niyo yung one half lengthwise na kasulat o ilan yung utang niya. O sabihin natin tatlo utang. The debtor has several obligations. Lahat yun, no? Lahat yun active, kumbaga. Tapos isa lang naman yung creditor. So kapag ganon, merong multiplicity of debts, so to speak. The debts are all of the same kind. Sabihin natin, all payment of a sum of money. Diyan papasok yung application of payment. So what are the requisites of that para magkaroon itong special form of payment na to? Firstly, there must be only one debtor and only one creditor. Next, there must be two or more debts of the same kind. All of the debts, of course, must be due. Unless merong stipulation to the contrary. Or if application of payment is made by the party for whose benefit the term has been constituted. Kasi sometimes, di ba, a term or period is put in place not necessarily for the benefit of the debtor, but for somebody else. Okay. And finally, the amount paid by the debtor must not be sufficient to cover all of the due debts. Okay. So yan ang requisites apat. So, sino yung may right to choose? Considering, balikan natin si debtor at saka si creditor natin, si debtor na may tatlong pagkakautang kay creditor. Sino ang pipili? Sino ang mag-a-apply ng payments? Is it the debtor? Is it the creditor? As a general rule, the right to apply the payment is vested on the debtor, no? Vested in the debtor. By way of exception, though, the creditor may apply the payment if the debtor does not avail of his right to choose. Okay, so that's one. O ayaw pumili or hindi pumipili si debtor. In that case, the creditor may apply the payment. Now, at that stage, no, hindi na ba pwedeng pumili si debtor? Pwede pa. Kasi once the creditor receives payment, tapos hindi naman kino-convey ni debtor na ito yung utang na gusto kong bayaran out of the three. The creditor will of course issue a receipt. Isusulat niya doon kung para saang utang niya in-apply yung payment. Now, if the debtor accepts the receipt as written, identifying which debt the payment was applied, if the debtor accepts that receipt issued by the creditor, then, no, basically, mararatify, mabavalidate yung choice ni creditor, yung kanyang application of payment. Now, of course, we also have this thing that we call legal application of payment. Basically, it is the law which makes the choice. Okay. Now, kailan papasok itong legal application of payment? If neither the debtor nor the creditor makes any application for of payment, so the general rule, it is the debtor who chooses, the debtor does not choose. Now, by way of exception, if the debtor does not make a choice, then it is the creditor which has the right to apply payment, but the creditor does not do so. So si debtor hindi gumagalaw, si creditor hindi gumagalaw. Okay? Or, if it cannot be inferred from other circumstances, talagang hindi mo masipat kung meron ba sa kanila na nag-apply ng payment. Wala whatsoever. Now, the law makes the choice. Which of the debts, which among the debts is the most onerous? No? Doon ia-apply yung payment. That's according to Article 1254 of the New Civil Code. So, this begs the question, class. Paano natin malalaman kung ano yung sinasabi nito na most onerous to the debtor? Basically, pinakamabigat, no? Pinakamabigat for the debtor. Here are the examples, basically. Number one, we have a debt na walang interest, no? Just the plain debt. And then meron pa tayong isa pang debt na merong naka-attach na interest rate. Sabihin natin 2% per annum. Syempre, mas onerous 'yun kaysa dun sa debt na walang interest, even though the other debt without an interest attached to it is older. That's according to the case of Menzi versus King Chuan. Now, what is another example? A debt as a sole debtor is more onerous than a debt incurred as a solidary debtor. Bakit? Bakit? Kasi, when we talk about a solidary obligation, well, syempre, I hope you still haven't forgotten, kapag solidary obligation, it is of course one where anyone among the solidary debtors can be held liable to pay the whole obligation. Na pwedeng saluhin, di ba? Pwedeng saluhin ng sino man doon sa mga solidary co-debtors. But of course, no? Pwede namang i-pursue nung paying debtor yung kanyang mga co-debtors for their respective shares. So ultimately, while sa una, isa lang sa kanila yung magbabayad, nagkakaroon pa rin ng contribution after the fact. No? Pwede pa rin niyang habulin yung kanyang mga kasama para doon sa patak nila, so to speak. And therefore, it is less onerous than a debt na ikaw lang mag-isa. Kasi, di ba, if you're a sole debtor, pag binayaran mo yung kabuuan ng utang, wala ka naman ng matatakbuhan eh. Di ba? For reimbursement. Of course not. Wala ka namang co-debtor, mag-isa ka lang. This is according to the case of Commonwealth versus Far Eastern Surety. Now, what is another example? A debt secured by a mortgage, by a pledge, etc. This is more onerous than an unsecured debt. Oh, ang payment ng, for example, no? A payment, an obligation to pay a row house. More often than not, kapag ikaw ay bumili ng bahay, yung obligation mo to pay is secured by a mortgage over that very same house that you bought. Okay? Na kapag hindi ka nakapagbayad ng certain number of installments, sabihin natin na miss mo yung pagbabayad ng mga 2-3 buwan, pwedeng ma-foreclose yung mortgage. Anong ibig sabihin nun? Pag na-foreclose yung mortgage, try asking your parents or your tiyuhin tiyahin about it. Alam nila yan. Kapag ikaw ay nakapag-tabi na ng sapat na pera para makabili ng sarili mong bahay, you have an idea of what I'm talking about. Kapag may na-miss kang payments, nag-accumulate yung mga pagkakautang mo, pwedeng i-foreclose o maremata sa Tagalog yung bahay. Babawiin yung bahay. Tapos ibebenta in a public sale sa sinumang interested buyer. So of course, that's more onerous than an unsecured debt. Okay? Kasi kapag hindi ka nakapagbayad, if you fail to pay an unsecured debt, ano lang naman ang ipagagawa sa'yo? Ano lang naman ang pwedeng gawin sa'yo rather? Pwede ka sampahan ng kaso for specific performance and or damages, di ba? Wala namang kukuning property sa'yo unless you have nothing to pay with. Saka pa lang pwedeng i-pursue yung properties mo. Diba? Remember the hierarchy of remedies, diba? Exhaustion of properties, etc. Pero subsidiary yun. unless and until wala ka na talagang pambayad na cash. But if the debt is secured by a mortgage, right off the bat, when you fail to pay, pwedeng i-foreclose yung mortgage. Kumbaga, hindi papasok yung specific performance kaagad. Entrada pa lang, the property mortgage, for example, a house, pwede yung mawala sa'yo, pwede yung mawala sa possession mo, pwede kang mawala ng bahay. So of course, that's more onerous, without a doubt, according to the case of Mission de San Vicente versus Reyes. Now, in comparison doon sa first example natin, doon sa, di ba, a debt with interest is more onerous than a debt without interest. Now, what if some or all of the debts are interest-bearing? Lahat may interest. Then, of course, the one with the higher or highest rate of interest, that is the more or most onerous. Now, an obligation with a penalty clause, no? An obligation with a penal clause, diba? Of course, it is more onerous than one without a penal clause. Now, of course, no? What if all of the debts are equally onerous? Sabihin natin, lahat ng debt, sabihin natin, tatlong pagkakautang, no? Three obligations to pay. Lahat may interest. Tapos pare-pareho yung rate of interest. What then, no? If the debts due are of the same nature and burden, then payment shall be applied to all of them proportionately. Anong implication nun? Yung binayad ni debtor divided by the number of debts. Tapos yun yung i-apply equally, proportionately, across all of the debts. Bakit? Because they are all equally onerous. Hindi ka pwedeng pumili ng isa sa kanila kasi pare-pareho lang sila ng bigat. Okay? Now, we are done with application of payment. Ano ang core ng application of payment? Basically, it redounds to choice. It is the debtor as a general rule, and by way of exception, the creditor who can choose kung saan amongst multiple debts, no? Kung saan i-apply yung ibinayad. Now, if the debtor and the creditor fail to choose, then it is the law that chooses. So that's application of payment. Now we move forward to another kind of special form of payment, which is what we call dation in payment or dación en pago. Dation in payment is the delivery and transmission of ownership of a thing by the debtor to the creditor as an accepted equivalent of the performance of the obligation. Basically, no. Dation in payment is this. Debtor approaches creditor. Sabi ni debtor, creditor, ang obligation ko sa iyo is to deliver a pizza pie. Kaso ang problema, kinulang ako sa ingredients for pizza pie. Gusto mo Bicol Express na lang yung ipagluto ko para sa iyo. Once the creditor accepts, that is dation in payment. Of course, broadly speaking, because when we talk about dation in payment, just so that you can visualize it better. Kasi dation in payment actually contemplates a money obligation. Para lang ma-visualize ninyo, no? Mas madali ma-imagine. Pizza pie, hindi kaya. So Bicol Express. So basically, that's the essence of this kind, of this special form of payment. What are the requisites, no? First, of course, like I said, there must be a money obligation. Now, next requisite. That the creditor, no, that the debtor rather alienates property in favor of the creditor with the consent, of course, of the creditor. And finally, the satisfaction of the money obligation of the debtor. So again, what does this imply? An obligation for the payment of a sum of money, napapalitan with the consent of the creditor with an obligation to give. Once the creditor accepts that alteration or that change in the obligation, then the obligation, the old obligation, the obligation to deliver or to pay money, is that obligation is deemed satisfied. Yan yung dation in payment. Oh, ito. Let's give a more accurate example. X owes Y 3,000 pesos. Kaso ang problema, nung time na to, walang ready na cash si X, no? At the time na nag-due yung obligation to pay. Kaso, meron siyang nakuha na 3,000 pesos worth ng tuna from General Santos City. Sabi ni X kay Y, "Nako, wala akong cash ngayon, pero kung gusto mo, hatian na lang kita dito sa tuna na nakuha ko from Jensen. Masarap to. Masarap ihawin ang tuna from Jensen, lalo na yung yung panga ng tuna. Good God, ang sarap." So, sabi ni creditor, nag-isip. Mahirap nga naman ngayong pandemic na makakuha ng tuna, Jensen. Makukuha ko to ngayon, hindi ko masabi kung kailan ako makakakuha nito ulit. At saka masarap ang tuna, Jensen. Ikilaw mo, iihaw mo, isigang mo, masarap. So sabi ni creditor, sabi ni Y, "Sige, deliver mo sa akin yung tuna, bayad na yung utang mo." That's dation in payment. Now, next, we go to payment by session. When we talk about payment by session, this is where the debtor abandons all of his property for the benefit of his creditors, in order that from the proceeds thereof, the latter may obtain payment of their credits. What are the requisites of this? There must be a plurality of debts. Maraming pagkakautang. Okay? Hindi lang isa. Sabihin natin, tatlong pagkakautang. Now, the debtor must be partially or relatively insolvent. Hindi na natin uulitin kung ano yung definition ng insolvency. Alam nyo na yon. And of course, the creditors must accept the cession. Basically, cession, what is the root word of cession? Seed. To seed. No? To concede, basically. Kaya, di ba, cession, concession. Di ba, nauuso ngayon kasi tapos na election. Some of the candidates have already conceded. Concede and seed. No? Concession and cession have the same common root word. Seed. To give up. To give away. Okay? So here, when we talk about payment by cession, walang pera si debtor sa kanyang maraming pagkakautang. Sabi ni debtor, "Wala akong pera. Hindi ko kayo kayang bayaran in cash. But here are my properties. Para sa inyo. In the hope na, by giving you my properties, we can consider that my obligations to you are already paid." Okay? Now, of course, no? Lalabas ito if we distinguish between dation in payment and payment by cession. Okay? Firstly, when we talk about dation in payment, there is only one creditor. Naturally. Payment by cession, of course, there are multiple creditors. There is a plurality of debts and a plurality of creditors. Maraming pagkakautang, maraming pinagkakautangan. When we speak of dation in payment, the debtor here is not necessarily in a state of financial difficulty. Diba? Wala yan sa requisites ng dation. It is entirely a matter of discretion. So hindi naman necessarily kailangan na hirap magbayad, no? Itong ating si debtor. Hindi naman nire-require na insolvent siya dapat. No, no. Pero pwedeng entirely out of kasi gusto niya lang. Okay? But in payment by session, the debtor must be partially insolvent. That there must be difficulty of some way, in some way or some kind doon sa kanyang capability to fulfill, no, or satisfy the obligations. Indation in payment, the delivery of the thing in lieu of payment in money, that is considered the equivalent of performance. Okay? Kahit na hindi sila of equal value. As long as the creditor accepts the delivery of the thing, that is already considered to be in satisfaction of the obligation to pay. Meanwhile, no, when we speak of payment by cession, the debtor here concedes the universality of his or her property. Gawin nyo na kung anong dapat nyong gawin sa aking mga pagmamay-ari, no? And basically, the procedure would be that the creditors will sell, no, the properties of the debtor. After which, no, yung proceeds nun, yun yung ipambabaya dun sa mga pagkakautang sa plurality of creditors. Now, indation and payment, payment extinguishes the obligation to the extent of the value of the thing delivered as agreed upon, proved, or implied from the conduct of the creditor. Okay? However, payment by cession merely releases the debtor for the net proceeds of the thing ceded or assigned. So kung kulang yung pambayad, kulang yung pera na nakuha o nakamal mula dun sa properties ni debtor na ibinenta, then the obligation will not be fully extinguished. Okay? However, when we talk about dation in payment, nakikita ninyo to, depende as agreed upon, proved, or implied from the conduct of the creditor. So pwedeng lesser in value, but if the creditor thinks that it suffices to extinguish the obligation, then that will do. Okay? Pero sa payment by cession, like I said, stricto yan. Kung kulang, then the obligation stands, unfortunately. Kahit na ibinigay na ni debtor lahat ng kanyang properties. If it is still not enough, then wala tayong magagawa. Okay? Sabi nga sa kanta, I did my best, but I guess my best wasn't good enough. Ganon sa payment by cession. Now, we finally go to tender of payment or consignation. You see, no? Tender of payment refers to the act of tendering or giving payment. Okay? So there can be tender of payment without consignation. The physical act of giving payment, the physical act of delivering the thing subject of the obligation, that is tender. Siguro familiar kayo dun sa phrase na tendering your resignation. Baka narinig nyo na o nabasa na ninyo. That is how you give your resignation letter. You tender. Okay? So tendering is giving. Okay? So tender of payment is the manifestation of the debtor to the creditor of his decision to comply immediately with his obligation. Ready na akong magbayad. Nasa kamay ko na itong produkto, itong thing na gusto mong ibigay ko. At ibibigay ko na to sa'yo. That is tender. It is the preparatory act. It is extrajudicial in character. Pwede kang mag-tender ng hindi dinidikta ng korte. Once the obligation is due and you manifest that you are ready to pay and you have in your hands, you have in your possession already the amount, no, or the money, that is tender of payment. Papasok ang consignation if tender is for some reason refused by the creditor. Like as a general rule, kagaya nga ng sinabi ko kanina, sinong tangang creditor ang tatanggi sa pagbabayad? The general rule is wala. But by way of exception, there are some creditors who refuse, no? Who refuse payment. Now, of course, sometimes tender is rendered impossible or inadvisable for some other reason or circumstance. All right? Na pwedeng wala sa control ng sino man sa mga parties. In which case, the debtor may deposit the object of the obligation, whether it is money or a thing, in a court. So kapag hindi tinanggap ng creditor yung bayad, ano ang remedyo ni debtor? Dapat ba siyang magkampo o magkuta doon sa harap ng bahay ni creditor? Mag-hunger strike ako dito. Hindi ako matutulog. Hindi ako aalis dito hanggat hindi mo ko pinagbubuksan, hanggat hindi mo tinatanggap yung bayad ko. Ganun ba yun? No. The remedy accorded by the law is for the debtor to go to court and deposit the thing, the object, or the money. Okay? This is a judicial act. It is judicial because it involves a competent court. So kapag hindi tinanggap yung bayad mo, takbo ka sa korte. Sa korte mo iiwan yung bayad or yung object, whatever kind of object it is. Now, kagaya nga ng sinabi ko, tender of payment and consignation are two different things. So, there are a number of requisites that have to come together in order for us to have a what I call a valid tender of payment and consignation combo. Of course, the debt, firstly, must be due. There must next be a valid and unconditional tender of payment. Next, no, you have to announce to the creditor that you will be consigning it with the court. Na, oh, ayaw mo tanggapin. Pupunta ako sa korte. Okay? You have to tell the creditor. There is an underlying reason for that. And what it is? What is it? No? It is grounded in common sense actually. Kailangan mong ipaalam sa creditor na sa korte mo iiwan yung pera or yung object kasi kapag nagbago na ang isip ng creditor na kukunin ko na, no? Alam ni creditor kung saan siya pupunta. Okay? Next, no, after you have announced to the creditor or the creditors that you will consign the thing with the court, then comes consignation proper. Consignation again is made by depositing the thing or things due at the disposal of a judicial authority. In other words, at the disposal of a competent court. After you have consigned the thing with the court, you make an announcement again. Okay? The consignation having been made, the interested parties, the creditor or creditors should also be notified. So you have to announce not just once, but twice. You announce to the creditor or creditors before you consign the thing, and then you announce again after the consignation. Okay? Don't forget that. I might ask that in the exam. Now, when is consignation deemed properly made? If the creditor accepts the thing or amount deposited without contesting the validity or efficacy of the consignation. Basically, if the creditor says, okay, nang hindi niya sinasabi na bakit mo kinonsign sa court, kung hindi niya kine-question yung act of consignation, then consignation is already deemed validly made. Now, the creditor may end up contesting the validity or efficacy of the consignation. Or maybe the creditor is not interested at all. Walang response. Or the creditor might be nowhere to be found. No? But the court in which the thing or amount is consigned after hearings, the court declares that the consignation was properly made. Then if the court says that there is valid consignation, who are we to question the court? Then of course, we follow the court's decision. Now, if the creditor neither accepts nor questions the validity of the consignation, yun na, the creditor is silent, and then the court after due hearings orders the cancellation of the obligation. So basically, the court makes a declaration that the obligation is already extinguished. It is extinguished by the consignation of the thing with the court. Once the court renders that ruling, di wala nang obligasyon. Bahala na si creditor na mag-redeem doon sa court kapag lumamig yung ulo niya o kapag nagbagong isip niya. As far as the debtor is concerned, wala na siyang utang, wala na siyang obligation. Now, should tender of payment always precede consignation? As a general rule, yes. You have to tender payment. You have to tender delivery first. Diba? Kagaya nga nung ating 5 steps kanina. Of course, the obligation must be due. Then you tender. Kapag may refuse or whatever, you announce that you will consign. Actual consignation, and finally, another announcement that consignation was already done. Tender should come first. But there are exceptions. Treat ang mnemonic. Tender of payment may not precede consignation if 2 or more persons claim the right to collect. Kasi, no? Kung mayroong 2 tao with conflicting claims, sabi ni alleged creditor A, sa akin yan dapat. Sabi naman ni alleged creditor B, hindi, sa akin mo yan ibigay. How can you do valid tender? You don't even know to whom you should actually validly tender payment. In that case, no, if there are 2 persons or 2 or more persons who claim the right to collect the thing or the money, then the logical way to go about it would be consign. Rumekta ka na mag-consign. Of course, you announce first. You announce to all interested persons na I will be consigning the item with the court. Doon na kayo magpresenta ng claim sa court kung sino ba talaga ang entitled para dito. But in order to get the right foothold, para wala tayong problema, sa court na kayo magpaliwanag. Doon ko iiwan yung pera or yung object. Yan. Next, if the creditor without just cause refuses to give a receipt, ayaw magbigay ng resibo ni creditor, huwag mo nang itender sa kanya. You go straight to consignation. Next, if the creditor is absent or unknown or does not appear at the place of payment. So A, absent. No? Malamang, wala kang matitenderan. Because the creditor is not around. The creditor's location is unknown. The creditor ghosted you practically. The creditor does not appear at the designated place of payment. So, kanino ka magtetender? Wala. E di go straight to consignation. So, I, the creditor, is incapacitated to receive payment at the time it is due. Again, wala ka mapagtetenderan. So you go straight to consignation. And finally, P, title. The title of the obligation has been lost. So if the title of the obligation has been lost, you can proceed straight to consignation without having to do prior tender. Next,